तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमयो, लेट द लाइट ऑफ नॉलेज रिमूव द डार्कनेस ऑफ इग्नोरेंस. आई एम डॉक्टर रुजुदा माचवे, सेक्रेटरी पूना ऑप्थल्मोलॉजिकल सोसाइटी, एंड आई वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर दिस मॉनसून डबल धमाका. लाइक लास्ट टाइम वी आर दिस टाइम हैविंग अ डबल धमाका, आर क्लिनिकल मीटिंग, सेकेंड क्लिनिकल मीटिंग एज वेल एज अ वेबिनार ऑन ऑक्युलोप्लास्टी. विल बी स्टार्टिंग विद द पीओएस क्लिनिकल मीटिंग फर्स्ट, फॉलोड बाय द ऑक्युलोप्लास्टी वेबिनार. फॉर द क्लिनिकल मीटिंग I invite the chairpersons, Dr. Sanjay Tekwade, Honorary President POS, and Dr. Sanjeevani Ambekar, Madam, Head of the Department, Ophthalmology Department, Sassoon General Hospital. The judges for today are Dr. Vaijayanti Devdhar, Madam, Past President POS, and Dr. Taswala, Sir, Past President POS. So before we start, may I request our Honorary President, Dr. Sanjay Tekwade, to make opening remarks. And then we'll proceed with moderator, Dr. Vrushali Varad, and she'll take care of that.
Thank you, Yuta. Good evening to all of you. It's indeed a pleasure to welcome you all. It's a special meeting because we have very good cases lined up and very good, interesting presentations by students from almost three reputed institutes. So without spending much time, I would request the moderator to start the clinical meeting.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Good evening and welcome.
Thank you, Yuta.
To this second clinical meeting of this year. Before starting case presentation, I request all the participants to strictly stick up to the timings, and that is 6 minutes for each case. And now, before wasting much of time, I would like to invite our first case presentation by Dr. Kanchita Pandey. She's a final year resident from the Dinanath Mangeshkar Hospital. Dr. Kanchita?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes.
Clear.
Okay, just a minute. Good evening, everyone. Myself, Dr. Kanchita Pandey, final year resident of Dinanath Mangeshkar Hospital, under the guidance of Dr. Shrikant Joshi and Dr. Devika Joshi, would like to present my case, management of pseudophakic myopia using implantable Collamer lens. Our case today, 35-year-old male patient came with complaints of gradual progressive diminution of vision in right eye more than left eye since many years. Patient had a history of congenital cataract for which he underwent cataract extraction and posterior chamber intraocular lens implantation surgery during childhood. Coming to the ophthalmic evaluation, the best corrected visual acuity in right eye was 618N6 with manifest refraction of minus 20 dioptric sphere, and left eye was 69N6 with manifest refraction of minus 9 dioptric sphere with a minus 3 cylinder at 110 degrees. Slit lamp examination of both the eyes anterior segment showed irregularly shaped pupil with broad peripheral iridectomy and multiple synechiae at the pupillary border along with an IOL in the capsular bag. So this is the photo of right eye and this is the photo of the left eye. Intraocular pressure in right eye and was 16 millimeters of mercury on Goldman applanation tonometry and left eye was 17 millimeters of mercury. Both eyes posterior segment examination with a 90 diopter lens post dilatation showed disc macula and periphery within normal limits. So coming, our provisional diagnosis was right eye pseudophakic myopia with left eye pseudophakic myopic astigmatism. Coming to the investigation part of it, the patient underwent an extensive ophthalmic checkup. So we did pachymetry for measuring the corneal thickness, specular microscopy for endothelial cell density, anterior segment OCT for anterior chamber depth and angle measurement, biometry for axial length, keratometry, wide-to-wide measurement by digital calipers, and OCT for disc and macula. So this, after the refractive analysis, this was the various measurements that we took, like wide-to-wide corneal thickness, AC depth, K1, K2, and endothelial cell density. Based on all of these measurements, we decided to place a right eye implantable Collamer lens by the piggyback technique. So I'll just show you the procedure. So So after the initial steps of mydriasis, cleaning draping of the right eye, followed by application of lip speculum, two side coats were made and clear corneal temporal incision at 180 degree of size 3.2 millimeter was made. Zone sinecure lysis using iris spatula was done. Then the ICL was placed in the bridge. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay, sir, just a minute. Right, just a minute.
Yes, yeah.
Okay. So like we can see, sinecure lysis was done using iris spatula. After that, the ICL was placed into the cartridge by making sure it is completely centralized. Then ICL was placed, the cartridge was placed into the injector and the lens was introduced into the anterior chamber. We had a complication wherein the ICL that after unfolding got everted everted in the anterior chamber. Even after multiple efforts to switch it back, it could not be done. Hence, we had to explant the lens and then re-implant the IOL, lens. Once the ICL was in the anterior chamber, using manipulators, the individual haptic of ICL was placed behind the iris one by one, and then followed by irrigation aspiration, and finally the side port hydration. I'll just start the sharing the presentation again. Okay, so post-operative follow-up, since we were expecting edema on the post-operative day one, we called the patient on day one, day three, day seven, and then a weekly follow-up was done, wherein the visual acuity, slit lamp examination, and IOP was measured. At 3 weeks, post-operative follow-up of right eye showed 6-9 paths with a +2 dioptric sphere, dioptric cylinder at 30 degrees, and IOP was 14 millimeters of mercury on NCT, and the patient's 6-week follow-up visit is awaited. So the first phakic IOL was designed to be placed into the anterior chamber, and it was implanted first in 1953 by Strampelli. Subsequent efforts have been made to improve the design and reduce the complication rate. Nowadays, US FDA has approved only two PIOLs, that is Vision ICL, which is an implantable collamer lens, which is placed in the posterior chamber, and Artisan, which is placed in the anterior chamber. And they are indicated mainly for phakic patients. So implantation of two or more posterior chamber IOLs was introduced by Guyton in 1993 in patients requiring higher IOP power or secondary correction for undesired optical lens. And this technique, this such lenses were coined as piggyback lenses or polypseudophakia. In our case, the patient underwent an off-label phakic intraocular lens implantation by a piggyback technique. So Huang et al. In 2009 conducted a literature search of PubMed and Cochrane Library, including 85 papers. And this was published as a report by American Academy of Ophthalmology, wherein they said that for higher refractive correction, PIOLs are preferred over LASIK and PRK. Piggyback insertion of implantable, our take-home message from this case is, piggyback insertion of implantable collamer lens appears to be effective and predictable in correcting refractive error in pseudophakic eyes. Thank you. These are the references.
Very nice presentation. Very innovative, yes. Also.
Kanchita?
Yes, sir.
Have you considered Sulcoflex, the Raynaud Sulcoflex lens, because that is also a piggyback lens? And why did you select ICL over a Sulcoflex lens?
Sir, actually, we could have gone with Sulcoflex lens as well, because it is sulcus placed, and since our patient is pseudophakic, so was not really a problem, but we prefer to go with vision. There's no such as such.
Chita, but the cost is very high for the ICL, where a piggyback lens costs quite a less of a amount. And we get the same result, an equivalent result. Or is the result more superior in this?
Sir, actually not many studies have been done. Few cases of piggyback lenses using vision ICL have been seen. So all showed predictable and good refractive correction. So hence we went with vision ICL.
Fine, fine. Thank you.
Your results were quite good, I think.
Yes, yes.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, the final 6-week follow-up is awaited. So we have to see the visual.
A nice case and good technique.
Yes, ma'am?
Yeah.
What was the amount of myopia you treated with this? What was the myopia?
Yes, so the patient had minus 20 dioptric sphere of refractive manifest refraction in the right eye, and we placed a minus 21 dioptric sphere IOL in the patient.
What do you think the reason for this pseudophakic myopia?
Ma'am, since the patient was operated during his childhood, so one of the reasons can be an inaccurate biometry at the time when he was first operated for cataract. Besides that, growing eyes can show myopic shift, and wrong use of formula when the first IOL was placed. That can be one of the reasons. And definitely inaccurate labeling of IOL is another option.
What do you think the best biometry nowadays preferred?
Best biometry, ma'am, optical biometry is best.
What do you understand by biometry?
Sorry?
What do you understand by optical biometry?
Ma'am, optical biometry works on the principle of interference, as against the ultrasound biometry, where sound waves are used to determine the actual length.
What could be the other alternative things for the treatment of such case?
Ma'am, since the refractive error is very high, so LASIK TRK would not have been a feasible option. The other option that we could have tried was IOL exchange. But in that case, since there were a lot of synechy and the patient was operated during his childhood, so obviously capsular adhesion was one of the anticipated possibilities. Hence, we decided to go with ICL. And of course, bioptics is always an option. But since by using one ICL, we can correct the entire refractive error. So that was why we went with it.
Panchita, what was the formula used for for the calculation of the power? Which formula did you use?
Sir, actually the lens calculation was given by the supplier, but I think modified vertex formula is what they commonly used. I'll have to confirm with the supplier what exactly did they use, but that is the general.
What company was this? Which company?
Ma'am, Vision.
Okay, now...
Let's go to the next. Nice presentation, Kanchita. And very good answer too.
Thank you, Kanchita, for a nice presentation. Now I request again Dr. Kanchita for her second case presentation.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, just a minute.
So, is there any problem? Shall I ask other speaker to present?
No, ma'am. I'm just actually having a little.
Rahul can load it otherwise. Amazing.
Just a minute, sir.
Dr. Harshita, please be ready with your case. Next, you are going to present.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am, is my slide visible?
Yes.
Yes. Under the guidance of Dr. Nikhil AK, I would like to present my case today. Polymicrobial endogenous infection that involves eye and eyebrow simultaneously in a post-COVID patient. So a 56-year-old male patient came with the complaints of right-sided facial tenderness and sudden progressive diminution of vision in left eye since the past 8 days. Patient had a history of COVID pneumonia 20 days back, for which he received systemic steroids and injection remdesivir. Patient also had a history of diabetes mellitus. So initial outside CT scan and MRI report suggested bilateral sinusitis involving all maxillary, frontal, ethmoid, and sphenoid sinus. MRI orbit done after 10 days of hospitalization showed mild erosion of the floor of right orbit and extraconal fat stranding with bulky heterogeneous enhancement of the right inferior rectus. So patient was taken up for functional endoscopic sinus surgery with right eye inferior orbitotomy, and the tissue sample was sent for sampling and culture and staining, which confirmed the presence of mucorrhizae. So coming to the ophthalmic evaluation, right eye vision was finger counting 3 meters, which was taken at bedside, extraocular movements were full and free in all gazes. Pupil was circular, reacting to light. Anterior segment on torchlight examination was within normal limit. Intraocular pressure was 15 millimeters of mercury on Goldman applanation tonometry. Posterior segment, post-dilatation, media clear, disc macula normal, and retina was on. So left eye vision was finger counting 1 meter bedside. Extraocular movements were full and free in all gazes. Pupil was circular, reacting to light. Anterior segment, torchlight examination was within normal limit, and intraocular pressure was 14 millimeters of mercury. Posterior segment post-dilatation showed hazy media due to overlying vitritis and a cream-colored pre-retinal exudate. The fundus showed multiple hypopigmented subretinal exudates with overlying vessels. So this is the fundus photo of the right eye, which is grossly normal, and this is the photo of the left eye. So we see a pre-retinal exudate, cream colored, and multiple hypopigmented exudates, which is subretinal. So our provisional diagnosis was left eye fungal endogenous endophthalmitis with rhino-orbital mucormycosis. So investigation, since the patient was post-COVID along with mucor, so we sent all the routine CBC, LFT, RFT, urine routine, electrolytes, HbA1c. Tissue sample collected from the FES was sent for Gram staining, Kuljewicz mount, Calcofold right, and culture sensitivity. And repeat radio imaging of CT and MRI was done to look for the progress. So the patient was given liposomal amphotericin B, 300 mg IV over 4 to 5 hours in a D5 pint along with 10 units of Ectrapid. And after 12 doses of amphotericin B, patient was switched to intravitreal posaconazole, which was 300 mg in 500 ml NS low and with drug monitoring and symptomatic treatment for other symptoms. In view of persistent vitritis, patient underwent pars plana vitrectomy with vitreous cutter sample. Sample was sent for culture and sensitive staining, and which confirmed the presence of aspergillosis species. Due to strong clinical suspicion of fungal endophthalmitis, empirical intravitreal voriconazole was given 100 microgram in 0.1 ml. And patient received total 3 doses of intravitreal voriconazole in subsequent follow-up visits as per the disease activity. On discharge, his left eye showed regressing vitritis and intact vision in the right eye. So coming to the discussion part, if we see the risk factors of mucorrhizae, we mainly diabetic, neutropenia, hematomalignancies, chronic steroid, immunosuppressants, and blood transfusions. As for aspergillosis, we have history of organ transplant and neutropenia. So mucorrhizae, typical appearance is broad hyphae with right angled branching, that is mucormycosis, and aspergillosis septate dichotomous with acute angle branching. When we see the manifestations, so mucormycosis is an angioinvasive, so it shows CRAO, then it shows combined atriovenous occlusions, orbital apex syndrome, cavernous sinus thrombosis, and multiple cranial neuropathies.
And aspergillus begins mainly from the choroid and subretinal space and shows retinochoroiditis with yellowish infiltrate, and then vitreous is involved, which is a late manifestation. And of course, till the anterior segment, it can spread. So, as per previous literature, polymicrobial infections are usually seen in pre-existing conditions such as malignancy, diabetes, organ transplant. With the ongoing epidemic, since our knowledge of COVID-19 manifestations are ever increasing, as per recent reports, mucor infection and invasive pulmonary aspergillosis are serious and potentially life-threatening complications. So, however, few cases have been reported of both their co-infection in a known COVID-19 patient. But as of our knowledge, there has been no case which reported co-infection of rhinorhabditis mucormycosis and endogenous aspergillosis, especially in the eye. The combined risk factors of diabetes, COVID-19, and recent corticosteroid treatment might have contributed to both infections in our patient. So our take-home message would be, in case of high index of clinical suspicion, the possibility of microbial infection should always be kept in mind, and hence clinical examination along with staining and culture reports should help, will help the clinician to establish a diagnosis and choose the best line of treatment. These are the references. Thank you.
Thank you.
How is the patient now? How is the patient now? Have you, when did you see the patient last?
Ma'am, patient was seen around 2-3 weeks back, and patient still has mild vitritis, but the retinochoroidal patches have reduced.
Good.
Dr. Taswala, sir, any questions? Hello? Hello? Yeah,
this was a rare case with polyfungal infection. Because we have seen either aspergillosis or mucormycosis, but both infections in the same patient and in two different eyes, I think this is the first time at least I am hearing about it.
Now, actually, the patient was under infectious disease specialist, so they had started all the antifungals. What we could have done was blood culture to at least recognize where the aspergillosis infection was coming from,
yeah.
Because we could only identify it in manifestation in eye, but nowhere else. Mm-hmm.
Anchita, very nicely done. Just one slide, you have written intravitreal posaconazole 300 milligram. It should be intravenous in the second slide or something, which I just noticed. Okay. By mistake, it should be a typo error.
Yes,
so anyway, very good presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Any questions from, I think Dr. Milin sir is there, or Dr.
Yeah, Milin can contribute definitely. Yeah. He can share what new things have come.
Is he there?
Is he there?
Yeah, I've been listening.
Yeah, Dr. Milin, yes.
No, no. Yeah, Milin. Hi, he's there, very much there.
Yeah, I haven't seen a mucor with
your comments.
Vitreous or the endophthalmitis and the orbital manifestation together. So this was learning for me too. We are seeing.
Yes, I said the same thing.
Ambika, ma'am.
I have come to know the first time. Very nice. That's why I said, Kanchita really got a good two case.
It's well-managed case, and usually we see all this manifestation a little late. In his case, we have seen as early after the 20 day. That is the one different point in the case. But what I must appreciate is the aggressive management from the all the possible route we can deliver the drug. That has really saved the eye like anything. I just congratulate for managing this case. Convey my congratulations to Dr. Beke also.
Yes, ma'am. Definitely.
Yeah, Kilan Kanchita. Very well managed.
Thank you.
So shall we move to the next case now?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Kanchita, for a nice case presentation.
Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you. Now I request Dr. Harshita Sharma. She is doing her fellowship in oculoplasty at HV Desai Eye Hospital to present her next case. Dr. Harshita.
Can you just share my slide now?
Yes.
Welcome, Harshita. All the best.
Thank you, sir. Is my slide visible?
Yes.
Go ahead.
So I'll be presenting a case where we have managed a congenital microphthalmos in an adult. She's a 25-year-old female who sought consult with us regarding facial asymmetry after discussed with her parents. She had a smaller left eye since birth, which had no visual prognosis. There was no similar history in her family, and all the syndromic associations were ruled out. On examination, external examination showed left eye superior circus deformity with inferior fornix shelving. There was a residual microcornea which was present. There was a medial band which was noticed, and a deficient fornices. The horizontal palpable fissure width had a difference of 4 mm between both the eyes, and a malar hypoplasia was also noted. There was a difference of 7 mm between the axial length of both the eyes. So after examination, we diagnosed the female with left eye congenital microphthalmos with microblepharon and grade 4 contracted socket. Our focus was on cosmetic rehabilitation of the patient, where we wanted to give her a well-fitted custom ocular prosthesis, and our goals were to provide a symmetrical palpable fissure width and a good eyelid shape and contour to her. The challenges that we were facing in this female was volume loss, there was surface loss, as well as corneal shortening. For the volume loss, we planned for an enucleation with microconjunctival technique and an implant placement. For surface loss, we augmented it with mucous membrane graft. And for corneal shortening, we did fornix formation suture and a conformer conformer placement and central tarsorrhaphy. So here in this video, you can appreciate the small microphthalmic eye, which has been carefully dissected by preserving as much as tissue which we can. Then there was a placement of 19 mm PMMA implant in the posterior tenon space. The was augmented mucous membrane graft taken from the lower lip, followed by a fornix formation sutures, which were placed both in the upper lip and the lower lip. So after 8 days, after 1 week of the surgery, we were able to appreciate the socket expansion efforts that we had made, and the central tarsorrhaphy was kept for 2 weeks in situ, and fornix formation sutures were placed for 4 weeks, and the post-operative care was given to the patient. Post 8 weeks, we appreciate a symmetrical palpable fissure width and symmetry of the contour and the height of the eyelids between the two eyes. Then our ocularist made a digital 3D printed custom ocular prosthesis for the lady. We can update the contour as well as the facial.
Harshita, your voice is breaking a little louder.
Yes, we can't hear properly. But we can see the results.
I think some internet issue is there.
Yeah, it's fine. Go ahead.
Yeah.
She has put the video off, so I think we'll have better streaming. We've lost this connection.
Can I go ahead, ma'am?
Yeah.
Yeah,
yes. You can hear you now.
This was the post-op picture after the COP was dispatched. Here we can appreciate there is a symmetry and a good facial cosmetic appearance of the lady. So anophthalmia, microphthalmia has been described as absence or presence of a small eye at birth. And the major concerns here are soft tissue abnormalities and the orbital volume deficit, which also results in hemifacial deformity. And at later age includes wear of ocular prosthesis. So at the presentation, if it is at a younger age, we can start earlier, because at birth and till 2 years of age, the facial growth is also occurring. So for a normal facial and orbital development, we can start earlier treatment. depending on the grade of presentation, mild to moderate grade, we can start with a serial conformer fitting, which will stimulate the surface and the fornicial growth. And if the presentation is late and the grade is severe, then the fornicial expansion can be done either by a conformer or a socket expansion. And the volume replacement can be done by implants or a dermis fat graft. So a congenital microphthalmia, which is a rare development delay, pediatric evaluation is a must. Detailed evaluation of ocular volume, surface, and the fornicial adequacy is important. Without any timely intervention, the socket remains underdeveloped and the ability to wear prostheses in later life is compromised. So an earlier intervention undoubtedly makes a huge difference in the emotional and psychosocial well-being of the patient as well as the family. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ashita.
Any questions? Very good presentation, Ashita.
Yeah, we could see the results are really excellent. Very nice.
I wanted to ask you, did the patient have any vision, Harshita?
No, sir.
No PL.
No PL.
Okay. And how do you decide the size of the implant?
So we did an agile length of the other eye. Of the other eye as well, sir.
Other eye, okay. Mm-hmm.
Yes, which was 24 okay. mm. So we put an implant of 19 mm in that eye.
Correct. Do you do
an MRI also, Arshita, for such cases to see the volume buildup, exactly how much of the implant size should be done instead of taking the other eye measurement?
No, sir, we generally do not send for an MRI for that. In case we are expecting any syndromic association where there are some brain abnormalities as well, in children who are presenting at a younger age, we do send them for a pediatric evaluation, and if required for that purpose, they undergo such imaging.
Perfect.
Right. You can also have this sizing spheres. So on table, you can use them and then you can decide, but for that you require an inventory of your implant. So if you want to be very sure, you can use the sizing spheres and then select your implant.
Yes.
If there had been a contracted bony socket, how could have been managed along with this? This is the volume deficit, okay? The socket seems to be all right, bony. If suppose there was some deficiency in the bony socket, what could be the line of management?
So, if the presentation is earlier, ma'am, then with the expansion of the socket or the hydrogels, with that, we can expand the socket and promote the growth of the sockets with socket expanders.
It already established. Any scope or stimulation of the orbit to grow. It was already, what's the age of this lady?
Her age is 25 years old, ma'am.
So it's hardly the stimulation can work. Definitely at anger gauge you could have stimulated. At suppose along this she had that bony limitations also. What could have been done?
In this female also, ma'am, she had malar hypoplasia. But with the adequate surface augmentation, we could give her a good contour and apparent fullness. Like the bony.
No, that's not my question. To implant something in the orbit, you need an orbital wall sufficient, okay? Orbit as the bony orbit should evolve completely. Suppose it has not evolved, the bony orbit is already constricted. What will you do?
Yeah,
we can do that by orbit expander, socket expanders can be placed, but that needs regular follow up and then augmentation and multiple visits for the patient.
I think we can add this to Dr.
Share such thing. One of the case I can share with you, just as this is the topic. We had a couple of cases, and one boy, we could do the orbit expand with the electric implantation and the lateral orbitotomy. That was an extreme contracted thing. That was the first stage we did the surgery, and after that the similar procedure, there is not much difference for the rest of the procedure. But that's one thought for addition.
Yeah. Then Dr. Milind, throw some light on.
Yeah, hi. Really nice kids presentation, Harshita. Madam was asking something very important. If the bony orbit is not grown well, if they present in the early childhood, you can put in expanders into the socket. And we are also trying out to just inject fillers into these sockets so that the bone, the socket can develop, the bony anatomy can develop. But if they present in adulthood, like Arshita's case, then it's very difficult to change that asymmetry which has occurred over years. So in these patients, what has been done for this patient is probably the best that you can do for the socket. And on top of that, the malar hypoplasia that she spoke about, you can try and camouflage that with fillers or maybe fat transfer. But the challenge is to catch them early on in life and start doing socket expansion.
Perfect. Thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Now I'll move into next case. I request Dr. Bhakti Mehta. She JR3 from BJ Government Medical College and Sassoon General Hospital to present her next case. Dr. Bhakti?
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, everyone. I am Dr. Bhakti Mehta. I'm a third year resident in BJ Government Medical College and Sassoon General Hospitals. I shall be presenting my case on ocular surface squamous neoplasm. So a 67-year-old female patient.
Your slides are not visible.
Yeah. Okay, ma'am, I'll just share it
again. Share your presentation.
Yeah. Is it visible now, ma'am?
No, not yet.
Yeah. Yes. Make it on a slide show.
Yes. Okay, sir.
Okay.
A 67-year-old female patient came to the ophthalmology OPD with chief complaints of irritation and foreign body sensation in the right eye since 2 years and a whitish mass in the right eye since 6 months. History of presenting illness, patient was apparently all right 2 years back, after which she started developing irritation and foreign body sensation in the right eye. She started noticing a whitish mass in the right eye 6 months back, which was painless, progressive, and gradually increasing in size. There was history of both eye cataract surgery 7 months back, history of topical chemotherapy in the form of interferon alpha 2b for 3 months. There's no history of ocular trauma, no history of significant weight loss. There's no history of diabetes, mellitus, hypertension, tuberculosis, asthma, or HIV. A patient was a farmer by occupation for 20 years before she became a housewife 10 years back. On personal history, sleep, bowel, bladder, appetite were within normal limits. There was no significant family history. Patient was conscious, cooperative, and well-oriented in time, place, and person. There were no palpable lymph nodes or skin lesions found. On systemic examination, the cardiovascular system, central nervous system, respiratory system, and per-abdominal system were within normal limits. On ocular examination, the head position was normal, ocular position was normal. Extraocular movements on both the sides were full, free, and painless in all gazes. On ocular examination, I shall be first describing my examination of the right eye because there were positive findings in the right eye. Visual acuity in the right eye with Snellen's chart was 6 by 60, which improved to 6 by 12 by a refraction of minus 0.75 sphere and minus 2 cylindrical at 170 degree. Tension, the intraocular pressure with non-contact tonometry at 11 a.m. was 13.4 millimeters of mercury. Lid was normal. On examination of conjunctiva and cornea, there was a fleshy white mass with internal vascularity present over the entire temporal bulbar conjunctiva in the interpalpebral fissure. The mass was non-tender and gelatinous in nature with two feeder vessels, and it was encroaching over the cornea from 8 to 12 o'clock with fimbriated edges and extending approximately 2 mm beyond the temporal limbus. The length of the lesion was 13 millimeters. The breadth was 11 millimeters. The rest cornea was clear. So this is the image of the patient on presentation. As we can see, there were fimbriated edges, which are also called as pseudopodia, which is encroaching towards the cornea. The total length was 13 millimeters, breadth was 11 millimeters, and the largest basal diameter was 11 millimeters. The rest of the examination of the right eye, that is iris pupil, or the shape, the size, was 4 millimeters, shape was circular. The direct light reflex and consensual right reflex was present. Anterior chamber was normal, depth and clear. The patient was pseudophakic. Examination of the posterior segment of both eyes with the 90 diopter lens and indirect ophthalmoscopy was within normal limits. So these are the investigations that we carried out. On anterior segment OCT, there was a thickened hyperreflective epithelium delineated from underlying normal epithelium. On ultrasound biomicroscopy, it did not show any intraocular invasion. On histopathological evaluation, there was conjunctival intraepithelial neoplasm grade 3. Basically, the slide showed abnormal dysplastic cells involving the entire conjunctival epithelium. So my provisional diagnosis is right eye ocular surface squamous neoplasm, stage T2 N0B M0 according to AJCC classification. And histopathology, it was CIN grade 3. On treatment, we did an excisional biopsy of the mass with a no-touch technique. The cryotherapy was done for the marginal base and with amniotic membrane grafting.
Thank you, Dr. Bhakti. Nice presentation. Ma'am,
thank you,
Vaijanti ma'am. Any questions?
What was the follow-up after this?
Yes, ma'am. The follow-up, the patient was operated just a week back. So on post-operative day one, so the picture that I've shown over here was of post-operative day one. So the monthly follow-up is still awaited, ma'am.
Okay.
Yeah.
That was good management.
Any questions from Taswala, sir?
What is the post-op protocol that you're following, Dr. Bhakti?
Yes, sir. So we have asked the patient to follow up monthly for 3 months. Later on, we'll basically look for any recurrent tumors or recurrent growth over there. And then after 3 months, we'll ask the patient to follow 3 monthly for 6 months, then followed by 6 monthly for a year. And she has to follow up every year for life.
And what is the treatment that you're giving on follow-up? What is the treatment recommended?
Currently we are on post-op, we are not giving any treatment, but if on examination and investigations, if we find any recurrence, we might start with interferon alpha-2b chemotherapies.
But aren't you giving any antibiotic eye drops or steroids or lubricants?
Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry. Yeah, that we are giving, ma'am. We have started with eye drop prednisolone. Already we have started with eye drop prednisolone and topical antibiotics were also given.
Perfect.
Yeah. Dr. Milind, sir, would you like to add something?
I enjoyed the presentation, and Bhakti, you're lucky to be in a place where you get to see all the spectrum.
Yeah.
The patient was in wonderful.
Yes, Shikha, today's presentation was very good. All three, all four.
All four presentations are very good. It's a very difficult task for us now.
Yes, for us also.
I wish I was in your field now, not a couple of years earlier.
I wish I was not a judge here.
But for mitomycin, I think you need to remember that mitomycin or even interferon are options to try and reduce the lesion first before you operate on it.
Sir, the patient had taken interferon before coming to us. And she went outside, she consulted somewhere outside, and she had taken interferon alpha-2b for 3 months.
Okay.
Yeah.
Milind, with regards to mitomycin, is it topical application of mitomycin?
Yes, it's in the form of drops and it's given in cycles. And this is usually done when the lesion is either diffuse or too extensive to be operated without causing a significant limbal stem cell deficiency. I don't do these cases personally, but just based on the teachings from Dr. Honauer and everyone else.
So one thing, if I may add, sometimes interferon alpha-2a in topical form might not work for these lesions. So in such cases, if the patient has not taken the immunotherapy from you, you don't know whether it was formulated properly first, whether it was stored properly, or whether it was used properly. So this case was really managed very well. But one additional thing which you can have as an option in the future could be, in such cases, since the height of the lesion was a little more than usual, it was not a top, typically flat lesion, you can give a subconjunctival or an intralesional injection of interferon alpha 2b. This also helps in sometimes downsizing the tumor, after which topical therapy works. So we have seen a lot of OSSNs which have responded very well to injections, subconjunctival, intralesional or perilesional
of
interferon alpha 2b followed by topical chemotherapy.
So you how frequent do you give this?
So these injections, the first injection is obviously given at presentation, and then you monitor them every monthly whenever you make the drops. So this is a combination therapy where you give the injection along with dispensing the drops. And then every monthly you formulate the drops till the lesion becomes flat, where it is more amenable to topical therapy, or you repeat the injections. Typically, three cycles is good enough to give you a fair idea about the response of the lesion. If it obviously doesn't respond for three cycles as well, then you go ahead with the surgery. If it responds for three cycles, then till the lesion is completely disappeared, you continue the immunotherapy for two or three more cycles, which is called as maintenance immunotherapy, and then stop and then monitor the patient 3 monthly for any recurrence. And
do you do histo for... sorry, madam. Sorry. Bolo.
What drug is given intralesionally?
Interferon alpha, the same drug which we make the drops.
Same drug. Okay.
And it's not very expensive. Each cycle should not cost more than 1,000, 1,500 rupees.
Okay. And what concentration and how much is the dosage that you give?
So, you get interferon alpha 2B in three concentrations. 1, 3 and 5 million international units per ml. If you get the 5 million international unit per ml vial, it is always better. Because more doses and less, like a less amount of solution.
Yes, madam.
Yeah, Ambikar, madam. Bolo.
All suggestions are very well taken. The thing is that there was many times we didn't get the written history, but here the patient has a previous record of taking the treatment. That's the one thing I'd like to know. Definitely, the follow-up and the meticulous net is required. There was being given and observed for 3 months. And second thing is to carry out the thing is the lesion was almost close to the optical axis. It was crossing the thing. And superiorly also, it was involved the fornix. So that was the one more challenge. The third thing is that in view of COVID, the management of this case with the compliance and long follow-up would have been a little bit difficult. The third thing, what I observed and I little bit modified in this case, which worked nicely, is I used around the limbus is the diamond burr to take out all the tissue, whatever is possible, because the cryo application aggressive would have not been very advisable in view of looking at the choroid reaction. And we followed closely the B scan also to see the choroid, how it's responding. And that was the systematically she forgot. We, as a support, I put her on the systemic steroid also with the proper dosage to have to avoid, I mean, to keep a close watch on the chloride detachment. And the one more thing I thought on the table, it could have worked looking at the cornea after the dissection, after doing the diamond burr and all, I extended the corneal graft over all the cornea, means limbus to limbus 360 degree. Even though the lesion was not there inferiorly also, and just anchored there, that has given a very good corneal protection and it's a very crystal clear cornea. It has worked like a hood for this. It's a one type of ulcer what we had created. So that couple of things I think has worked good in her case. And the healing has been very good beyond the expectation. I could have not expected such a crystal clear anterior segment within a week. But that amniotic membrane has really worked well when I put it like that on the rest of the cornea also.
Very nice management.
Was there any destruction of the limbal stem cells? Was it invading deep at the limbus?
No, it is not much. No. But there was like just like an a few fibrous strands were there and a little bit and hard core at the limbus where the actually there was the base of the tumor was there. That's mm-hmm. why I thought yeah. to clear it off as much as possible, this fibrous gland, because that becomes one of the factor for the recurrence, even though a neoplastic or the growth and the fibrosis again. So mm-hmm. that diamond bar really works well. Even I try this all as regularly in the advanced cases where we need grafting in the pterygium case.
Yeah.
A grade 2 and more than that, whenever is required, or when you're operating on the recurrence of the recurrent pterygium. This, what I feel is complete taking of the all these fibrous strands cell by cell, that really works well for any recurrence.
It polishes the corneal tissue very nice, the diamond bar.
Quite good. At the limbus to take out the fibrous tissue, not on, exactly on the cornea.
Cornea, correct.
The fibrous part of the cornea.
Correct.
Yeah.
Very nice.
Wonderful webinar is in a pipeline, so I think we will stop here. Before that, I thank all the participants for a wonderful presentation, all the judges. I also thank Dr. Tekade sir and Dr. Ruchita for giving me this opportunity. And now I request Dr. Ambika ma'am to conclude this session. Yes, sir, you were saying something, Tekade sir?
Good evening to you all. Yeah. Very nice to see you, the Milin, again in the webinar and the rest of the speakers also. It's always interesting to hear him. And very nice presentation for all the presenters and their faculty. I must congratulate them for encouraging them and keeping up the subject in line. And the show must go on. And I can proceed for the webinar.
Yes.
Thank you. I wanted to say we should thank. Yeah.
Very good. Excellent.
And thanks to Tekade sir for giving me the opportunity to share this session. Okay. And at least we are meeting virtually, Devdar ma'am, and rest of the thing.
Yes.
Yeah, we have very sound memories when she was the first president.
President. I'm seeing you after many years, Dr. Ambikar.
Right, ma'am.
He is managing the show very nicely, Dr. Ambikar, madam. Thanks, Dr. Tekade and Dr. Ruchita and the POS committee for giving us the chance to become the judges. Very nice case presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambikar, madam, to be there and co-chair the session. I think you also gave very good insights. I mean, it was a great learning experience for all of us. And we will continue this same learning in our upcoming webinar.
Thank you, sir.
Stay with us.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes,
sure.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
It was a great session with an array of different cases and very difficult to manage cases, which were managed very ably. So I thank all the judges, the chairpersons, and yes, I congratulate all the speakers. So now moving on to our next session of oculoplasty and facial aesthetics. We are lucky to have Dr. Milind Naik with us, who's my classmate and friend from BJ Medical Government College. And he's a plastic ophthalmic surgeon from LV Prasad Eye Institute. Along with him, we'll be having POS faculty, Dr. Ramesh Murthy and Dr. Adit Gupta. So without any delay, may I hand over the session to the moderator, Dr. Nitika Tripathi. Over to Dr. Nitika.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, ma'am. After a very informative clinical meet, now let's move out to the very much informative clinical treat by our masters. Let's move out to the master's class from our oculoplasty experts. So on behalf of POS, I welcome you all for the webinar of oculoplasty and facial aesthetics. So today's webinar, we are going to have three sessions, three lectures on which there are two speakers from POS and one is from our guest speaker. So now I welcome all for that. One ma'am, I'll just share the screen. I forgot. Okay. So in this rainy season, I have just put this welcome sign for some freshmen. So the welcome address was by Dr. Rujita Machwe. Now I'm going to introduce our first speaker, who is Dr. Ramesh Murthy. He's our own POS speaker. So about Dr. Ramesh Murthy, sir, he is a cataract surgeon and oculoplastic surgeon, and also squints and pediatric ophthalmologist. He has done his double fellowship. His education is graduated from AFMC, trained at Arvind Eye Hospital, Madurai, and he has completed 3 fellowships from L.V. Prasad Eye Hospital, Hyderabad, and Moorfield University, London. His former senior consultant at L.V. Prasad Eye Hospital, Hyderabad. He has over 130 publications, out of which 63 are PubMed. Presentations, he has over 750 talks, out of which 21 were international. He has got 37 awards in his medical career, 5 awards from the American Academy of Ophthalmology, out of which achievement he has LEO award in the ophthalmology and American Academy of Ophthalmology. International Ophthalmologist Education Award by American Academy of Ophthalmology and the Physician Recognition Award from the American Medical Association, actually, mammoth of introduction for sir. He is a reviewer of Archie's American Journal, British Journal, IJO, JCOR, OPRS, JAAO, POS, IOBS, and 17 more journals. He's a member of AAO, Orbis International Faculty Invited Board Member of American Association of Pediatric Ophthalmology and Strabismus. He's Executive Committee Member of Oculoplasty Association of India. He's teaching faculty as Orbis International Flying Eye Hospital. And he's Section Editor of Pediatric Ophthalmology, Indian Journal of Ophthalmology, Conference Coordinator in our own Pune Ophthalmological Society. Now I'm handing over it to sir. I'll just stop sharing the screen. Okay. Over to you, sir.
Okay. Share screen.
So you can share your screen now.
Yeah, I'm sharing. I'll make it full screen. Let's see. Thank you, Dr. Nitika, for your kind introduction. And I want to thank Dr. Tekavade, sir, Dr. Rujita, and everybody in the POS team for their fantastic tenure and the variety of programs and innovative ideas that they have created for POS to keep us all enlightened, keep the learning going on, and to keep us entertained. So today we'll be talking about lid suturing techniques and lateral assisted procedure. Is my slide visible and can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Ramesh, yeah, we can see your slides. Yeah.
So it's a very basic talk on lid suturing techniques. First, it will be worthwhile just revising some of these ideas. So my talk is about art of surgical technique and lateral assisted procedure. So in the operating room, the ideal operating room should be like this, where you have the patient lying here in the center, the surgeon is at the head end. And then there is the anesthesiologist who is here on the left. And there is an assistant who is standing here. There is a Mayo stand, a scrub nurse, and there is a circulating nurse here. And there is a back instrument table. But this is the ideal thing. It does not happen all the time. But what we can do better is to go for good skin incision. So all the skin incision that we make is along the natural skin crease, because this will cause least amount of scarring. And this is always adjusted to the anatomic structures to hide the scar. Like in the upper lid, we go for the upper lid crease incision. For the lower lid, we go for the lower lid crease incision. And these are all the areas where we can give incisions, like above the brow or subbrow incision, then in the region of the scalp, in the forehead. So all these skin incisions, we use local anesthesia with epinephrine. The reason we use epinephrine is to create hemostasis. So when we use the scalpel blade, we use number 11, which is a sharp point. It is only for cutting deeper into the tissue. But the best blade for cutting the skin is a number 15 blade. And you can see that when you draw the blade, you move it from point, suppose you have to make a cut from A to C, move it from point A to B, and then from B to C. So it is point to point movement of the blade. And number 15 blade is a very good blade for cutting the skin, just the skin alone. Next, using the scissors. Now, when you use the scissors are actually not used to cut the tissues, especially in the region of the lids. We use it to separate the tissue planes. We grasp the tissue layers which need to be separated. Where we want to cut, we hold it close and then you pull the tissues apart and then you look for any fibrous bands or anything that you want to cut, and you make small controlled closure with scissors and don't keep on snipping like the barber does. It's very important to understand that. And always hemostasis is very important in the region of the lids, because lids have got a huge amount of vascular supply. So we use local anesthetic with epinephrine, 1 in 1 lakh or 2 lakhs. We can do tamponade. We can use cautery. Is definitely very useful in the lids. So ideally, we should always operate with a radio frequency cautery. And of course, if you use, you can use bone wax for the orbits, drains, and suction when you do orbital surgery. Now about the sutures. Basically, there are two kinds of sutures: the monofilament and the multifilament. The monofilament is a suture like the proline, which has got less tissue reaction. It is easy to pull out, but this needs a first 3 throws and then 1 through and then 1 through tie. But the multifilament is a suture like Vicryl, which is more like a rope. The good thing is it will maintain the tension and it will hold the knot better. And here you can go for a first throw, second throw, and a third throw tie. The needles are different types, the taper needle, the conventional cutting, the reverse cutting, and the spatulated. The taper point is one which is going to push through the tissues like you want to suture the gut. But the cutting needle is the one which is very useful because it not only cuts, it facilitates penetration, and you can enter the tissues very nicely without creating a large gaping hole inside the tissues. So most of the needles that we use are usually the spatulated or the reverse cutting needles. Now the suturing technique is very important. We keep on suturing a lot of skin wounds, but it's important to understand the basic principles behind the suturing technique. So if you look here carefully, the needle enters the skin vertically. The needle enters the same depth on both sides of the wound. This is very important. And when you tie it, the wound gets elevated slightly. So there's a puckering of the wound upwards. So what happens is when the scarring occurs, you'll have a flat wound and not a depressed scar. The second thing is when you use a double mattress suture like this, again, you can see that the distance or the depth on both sides is the same. And the distance from the wound margin for both these sutures are equal. So this gives rise to an elevated wound, a puckered wound. So once it scars and heals, it will heal with a flat scar and not a depressed scar. So when we pass the sutures, suppose we're cutting the upper lid skin, the upper lid crease, and we're doing a ptosis surgery. This is how the needle needs to be passed so that the passage of the suture through the wound is always vertical to the wound. And what you see externally is this oblique path of the suture. So it's very important to have a vertical kind of intersection between the wound and the sutures. The other technique which I want to highlight is the theory of halving. So whenever you have a wound, you keep on halving the wound so that it becomes a perfectly opposed wound and you have all the sutures equidistant. So here we pass a suture in the center and then between these two, we pass one more suture and so on. Also, dog ears are very important, especially around the lids, especially the temporal aspect or on the lateral part of the eyelids and below the eyebrows. So always get rid of these dog ears. Otherwise, they always look very unsightly and ugly. So cutting a dog ear is very important. We cut it in the form of a triangle. A few words about the anatomy of the lids, just a revision. We have the anterior lamella and the posterior lamella. The posterior lamella containing the meibomian glands and the orifices. And the anterior lamella containing the orbicularis and the lashes. And between these two is the junction. And this junction is also called as a gray line. So the tarsal plates are the skeleton of the lids. They are about 10 millimeters in the upper lid and 4 millimeters in the lower lid. And this is how we suture any kind of lid wounds with the double mattress suture, especially for the upper lid. And we pass the sutures actually through the tarsal plate. This is very important to understand that we don't pass it through anterior part, we pass it through the posterior part, that is the tarsal plate, because that is a rigid structure which will hold the tissues in place. Now let's talk a little bit about this procedure of lateral tarsal strip. And this is a patient who is having tarsal ectropion. As you can see that the lid is averted very badly and is look not only is causing a lot of inflammation for the patient, it's also not looking very nice. So the best procedure for, or the most common procedure or the most useful procedure, which I would suggest is to do a lateral tarsal strip. So in the lateral tarsal strip, what we do initially is to do a lateral canthotomy and an inferior cantholysis. Sorry, one moment. Some of the video, yeah, maybe not. Yes. So what we do is we go ahead and we make a snip in the lateral canthus and then we cut off the inferior canthal ligament or the inferior canthal attachment of the lateral canthus. And here you can see that this is what we have done. Let's just start the video. So this is the lower portion of the tarsal. We made a small tarsal wedge here. And then we're trying to pull it and trying to oppose it to the lateral orbital margin to see whether it is opposing tightly. So having cut this portion of the lateral canthus, we made a small lateral tarsal strip where we've removed the conjunctiva and the skin on that aspect. It's a small strip which will come and we'll get suturing to the periorbita. So here we are exposed the periorbita superior laterally, and it is very important to pass the sutures from this lateral tarsal strip end right through the inner aspect of the periorbita from the inside out and above the region of the midline. So it will go slightly on the higher side and give a very good lift and proper alignment of the lid. So here we are using 6-0-proline or 5-0-ethibond stitch, passing it through this lateral tarsal strip which we have fashioned. And then the cat's paw is in place and we are passing the sutures through the periorbita. So we make a temporary knot and we see how good the apposition is and whether it is tight in position. There should not be any gape. And once it's tight in position, then we can go ahead and finalize the knot. Once we finalize the knot, then we close the tissue with 6-0 vicryl and then we trim any excess skin which may be present. As you can see, there's a lot of excess skin which has been created. So this is like a dog ear. So this is a triangle that we have created and we're going to cut off this triangle and we have to suture this skin. So this is how the patient looks at the end. So here the lid has been tightened by doing a lateral tarsal strip, which is sutured to the periorbita superior laterally with non-absorbable sutures, and the external tissues are actually sutured with either 6-0 vicryl or 6-0 proline as the case may be. And this gives very good outcome. So this is how the patient looked before surgery and the patient looks after surgery. It will look a little tight immediately after surgery, but over time it will relax and become much more loose. Thank you for your attention.
Very nice presentation, Dr. Ramesh Murthy, sir, as expected from you. Yes, sir. So let's move forward towards next speaker. Actually, I'll share the screen. Actually, I was also a UG from BJ Medical College. So after seeing Ambekar ma'am, I have become a little nervous. Actually, she was the teacher and we all used to have some scare from her. And after seeing her, it's nostalgic. Went back to my UG days. The next speaker is Dr. Adit Gupta. Dr. Adit, he's a plastic surgeon. It's not clear to me. Okay, it's a plastic and reconstructive surgeon, oculoplastic surgeon. He's now at Mumbai Eye Plastic Surgery Hospital and HBT Medical College and RN Koppal Hospital. He's attached over here. And in Pune, he's attached to Dinanath Mangeshkar Hospital. Dr. Gupta is double fellowship trained fellow and he has trained extensively in the ophthalmic plastic surgeon surgeries and facial aesthetics. Actually, it's not visible, right? Okay. Dr. Gupta completed his master's at PGI Chandigarh, followed by his training at LV Prasad Eye Institute, and he stopped in it with an international fellowship at the UCLA Stein Eye Institute, Los Angeles. His main area of interest are oculofacial aesthetics, eyelid reconstruction, thyroid eye disease, and ocular GVHD. He lectures extensively and has 22 peer-reviewed international publications. He is also the editor of a book, Advances in Oculoplasty, published by Springer. He provides oculoplastic and aesthetic services in the metropolitan cities of Mumbai and Pune. So let's move forward to Dr. Adit Gupta. Adit, over to you. You can share your slides now. Dr. Adit.
Okay. Is it visible? Is my slideshow visible?
Yes.
I would take this opportunity to thank Dr. Nitika for introducing me. and also Dr. Tekaude sir, Dr. Rujuta and team POS for giving me this platform and opportunity to talk about entropy on surgery. So Dr. Ramesh Murthy has already made my talk easier by explaining all the basic principles and the anatomy of the eyelid. What I'm going to do is basically try and explain lower eyelid entropion, since I've been given a time of around 9 to 10 minutes. So to do whole justice, I would just talk about lower eyelid entropion today. Now, as we all know broadly, lower eyelid entropion is basically classified into two types, involutional and cicatricial. And sometimes very rarely you might even encounter the spastic variant of lower eyelid entropion. What we are going to focus today on is mostly the involutional variant and a little bit about the cicatricial lower eyelid entropion. Now, this is one of the most common conditions encountered by general ophthalmologists, residents, and oculoplastic surgeons in their day-to-day practice, wherein usually an old adult or female patient walks into your clinic with eyelashes rubbing onto the cornea. Now, the most common condition that we see is involutional lower eyelid entropion, which can be caused because of the laxity of the lower eyelid retractors, because of laxity of the eyelid, overriding orbicularis muscle, and sometimes loss of support due to enophthalmos. Now, to make everything simple for the residents and for general ophthalmologists, I always imagine the eyelid like a hammock. So basically, the eyelid is like a sling with two hinges. So if you look at the hinges, it's basically the canthal tendons on either side, the medial and the lateral canthal tendon. And then this is the eyelid, which can be considered as the lower eyelid for this convenience. And depending on the forces acting on the eyelid, it can either go into entropion or ectropion. So basically, the pathophysiology of entropion or ectropion, except the paralytic variant, is the same. And it all depends on the forces acting along the hinge. So if you have a lax medial or lateral canthal tendon, the eyelid can either go into entropion or ectropion, depending on where the contracture is. If the orbicularis is hypertrophic or overriding, it is going to cause an entropion because the eyelid is going to move inwards. On the other hand, if the orbicularis is lax and doesn't have adequate tone, then the eyelid is going to go into an ectropion. Similarly, on the conjunctival side as well, if the conjunctiva contracts, the eyelid is going to contract inside and is going to go into an entropion. Now, cicatricial entropion we'll come to later, but let's go ahead with involutional type of entropion. Now, if you look at the cross section of the eyelid, if we cut the eyelid into half, as seen here, this is the lower eyelid. This is the fornix of the lower eyelid. This is the eyelid skin, this is the eyelash, and this is the inferior oblique muscle in cross-section. Now, we all know that the capsulopalpebral fascia is basically the fusion of the capsule of the inferior oblique and the inferior rectus muscle, and along with the rudimentary retractors of the eyelid, it goes and attaches to the surface of the tarsus at the pole of the tarsus as well as a little bit on the anterior surface of the tarsus. Now, this is very similar to the upper eyelid anatomy, except that the retractors of the lower eyelid are not as strong as the LPS muscle of the upper eyelid. And that is why entropion happens in the lower eyelid. Now, before we go on to the management of involutional entropion, basically there are quick OPD tests which we should do before managing these patients. One is the most important distraction test, where we just pull the lower eyelid down and measure. If the lower eyelid could be pulled more than 6 to 10 millimeters away from the globe, then it is obviously a lax eyelid. If it is more than 10 millimeters, it is severe laxity. Between 6 to 10 is mild to moderate laxity. Similarly, if you pull the medial or the lateral canthal tendon away from their origins and insertions, the eyelid excursus. So in this patient, if you see, the lateral canthal tendon is certainly lax. It should be the lateral canthus. This is the orbital rim that you see here. The lateral canthus should be somewhere over here. This should be the lateral canthal tendon insertion. You can see that it is obviously displaced and is lax. So lateral canthal tendon and the medial canthal tendon laxity should be assessed. And last but not the least is the snapback test. Now this can be classified depending on different grades. This is important for the resident. But you just pull the eyelid down and let it snap back and recoil to its original position. Usually a normal eyelid should return immediately on release, while a grossly lax eyelid returns to position either on blinking or stays distracted, as seen here. You can see that there's a gap between the globe and the eyelid. Now, there is one more sign which is been published, where you pull the lower eyelid down and if you see fornicial fat prolapse, that is a very high indicator for involutional entropion. Now, involutional entropion can be treated in many ways. Usually, a surgeon works on one surgery which works best on his hands. Today, what I'm going to talk about is basically the Jones procedure, but you should also know a little bit about the Quikert suture, which is very important, especially in cases which require urgent cataract surgery or bedridden debilitated patients, where you just take a suture through the fornix and tie it on the skin. So three sutures are taken, which help in eversion of the eyelid by forming a contraction band. Coming to lower eyelid entropion surgery, what we perform basically, the commonest surgery performed is the Jones procedure. Now, in Jones procedure, what is basically done is you go ahead and attach the detached retractors of the lower eyelid. So surgery basically begins by taking a stay suture. This can be taken with 6-0 Vicryl, which you're going to use further in your surgery. After that, once the eyelid is taut on the stay suture, you can either make an incision with a radiofrequency monopolar electrode or with a cold steel 15 number blade. After this section is done, the orbicularis muscle is encountered. Now, this orbicularis muscle is usually vascular, but hemostasis can be achieved by injecting lignocaine with retinoline. Now, dissection here has to proceed very slowly because what you see here is the tarsus. Once the tarsus comes into view, you see the marginal arcade here. So this is the marginal arcade of the eyelid and the orbicularis is being dissected from the orbital septum. Now you can see that the marginal arcade of the eyelid runs along the pole of the tarsus. Now dissection has to proceed very slowly here because the retractors are a very thin layer. Usually they are identified as a white line or a white band. You can start to see the white band here in the lower eyelid and this is the fornicial conjunctiva. So you should be careful not to make a buttonhole or an incision in the fornicial conjunctiva, but it doesn't matter even if a buttonhole is made. Now what I'm holding is basically the lower eyelid retractors. So you dissect the retractors from either from both the anterior and the posterior surface, depending on the detachment. To know that you're in the right plane, you will start seeing the pre-apanerotic eyelid fat. So this is basically where the retractors are. This is the pole of the tarsus, the diagram which I had shown before. Retractors can also be identified by looking for faint movement when the patient is asked to look in up gaze and down gaze. So what I'm holding now is the retractors. You can also feel a mild tug when you ask the patient to look. Now the yellowish thing that comes into view is the pre-apanoritic fat band. And what I'm incising now is the septum which is present, which holds the fat into position. Now with the help of a Demas retractor, which your assistant can hold, you can either choose to dissect the orbital septum or just pass a suture via the retractors and then through the tarsus, taking care not to make a full thickness incision. So these sutures are passed partial thickness via the tarsus and that is why we use a spatulated needle. You also check on the inner surface because you don't want these sutures to erode and irritate the cornea. Once this is passed, you make a temporary or a permanent knot depending on your confidence levels. And then when you tighten, you can see that the eyelid everts. So this is a good sign that you have achieved fair success during the surgery. Now, with experience, you also come to know the amount of orbicularis muscle tone due to the anesthesia effect. But fair overcorrection is a good endpoint for the surgery. Now, these are two more sutures which I take after the central suture for the medial and the lateral ends. Similar fashion, partial thickness through the tarsus and then tied. After this, what one additional step, especially in patients with a hypertrophic orbicularis, is preseptal and pretarsal orbicularis debulking. So a thin strip of orbicularis is then stripped off from the eyelid to prevent overriding of the orbicularis again. Now, this adds value, especially in cases where there has been a recurrence of entropion in the lower eyelid. Some people choose to excise a little bit of skin as well, depending on the amount of excess skin. Surgery ends by taking intermittent sutures to close the incision, and the incision heals very well with almost negligible scarring, which can be seen in the postoperative picture. These Vicryl sutures should be cut flush or they can be left alone. Usually they dissolve and fall off in 2-3 weeks or you can choose to remove them after a week. Our results are fairly predictable. You can expect a little bit of ectropion in the first 2-3 days after the surgery till the orbicularis returns. But usually the patient does very well. Now, sometimes these procedures have to be combined. Sometimes these procedures have to be combined with tightening procedures, just like Dr. Murthy showed. You might have to do an additional tarsal strip procedure if there is gross laxity of the eyelid. So there's no one rule fits all for entropion procedures unless the eyelid is taut. Now, coming to the second component of psychiatricial ectropion, usually psychiatricial ectropion develops in patients with psychiatricial anomalies of the eyelid. It can happen in OCP patients, Steven Johnson's patients, and very commonly we see in our practice is in patients with scarring of the lower eyelid, either after a surgery or trauma. So this young lady had a lower eyelid entropion after a blepharoplasty surgery where aggressive conjunctival cautery was done, due to which she also had tethering of the inferior oblique muscle, which was also causing diplopia and symblepharon of the eyelid. Now, in such cases, there is no option but to go and release the psychiatrics and the scarring as seen here. The same procedures like for lateral tarsal strip surgery is performed. A cantholysis is done. After this, in an N-glove fashion, without increasing the incision, this is minimal incision, you're entering with a Steven scissor and dissecting off all the scar tissue. You can see the fibrous bands here. They are adherent to the inferior orbital rim. So these fibrous bands are then released. And then you can see the focal symblepharon, which is present here, is released because you want to conserve conjunctiva as much as possible. This is the inferior oblique muscle, which you can see in the inferior fornix, which is then also separated from all the adhesions. Now, once you have removed this, there is obviously a shortage of the mucous membrane or the conjunctiva. The conjunctiva looked healthy. So what we did was we harvested a fat strip, just like a dermal fat graft, which we use for socket. And then we place this strip over the lower fornix to prevent any further adhesions and to prevent symblepharon formation and let the conjunctiva grow over it. Now, this helps in improvement of, since it adds as a spacer as well. So you can see that the lower eyelid now is lifted up as compared to the lower eyelid here. It has got good shape and the entropion is corrected as well. So for cicatricial entropions, you need to add spacers and sometimes augment the posterior mucosal surface either with some mucosal grafts. If there are any questions, I can take them in the end, but my talk is done. Thank you.
That was a wonderful talk, Adit. After this talk, we have a question answer session only on entropion and ectropion. Wait. I have shared. Okay. Any questions from the audience? Okay.
Adit, that was an excellent presentation. We saw you using RF cautery, that's radio frequency cautery, so well. But suppose you don't have it and you're using a steel blade, then would cautery cause some amount of scarring, or would you just depend on your good infiltration of xylopain and for that? Because bleeding is a problem if you don't have a RF cautery. Yeah.
So, thank you, sir. That is a very relevant question. So end outcome usually doesn't change whether you use a cautery or just scissors and forceps. The only thing is that the surgical time is shorter if you have a bloodless field, because you don't waste time by to apply pressure for the bleeding to stop. Secondly, I think bruising also sometimes is lesser when you use a cautery. So the edema and all subsides faster. But there is a second school of thought which says that cautery causes more swelling and edema and the healing takes longer. So actually, it's just like whether the hen came first or the egg came first. So it's still a debate, but both the instruments and tools work best in a particular surgeon's hand. You don't need to have a radio frequency cautery all the time. You can even use a bipolar cautery to pinpoint, cauterize the feeders. And these bipolar cauteries, which are present with phaco machines or the squint bipolar cauteries, work equally well during dissection as well.
Okay, thanks. Because one concern for, you know, general ophthalmologist is oozing. Yes. We are so not used to oozing in our routine cataract surgery.
Usually, once you pass the orbicularis plane, the oozing usually doesn't happen that much because the fat and all usually is contained within the septum and the retractors are mostly avascular. So it's the orbicularis that oozes the most and the tarsal arcade if you by mistake cut it. These are the two points where oozing mostly happens.
Beautiful demonstration, yeah.
Okay. Any more questions from the audience? Adit, one question from my end. Is it advisable for the general ophthalmologist to learn entropy and ectropion? Is it easy? We can operate, or we should take some certain short-term fellowship is sufficient, or we need long-term only for this kind of surgeries?
I think I've seen a lot of general ophthalmologists doing very good entropion surgeries. I think Tekavde sir himself does very good entropion surgery. So I don't think it is a contraindication, because it is a part of our ophthalmology training. Usually, if you have good surgical skills, a fellowship, separate fellowship for entropion surgeries might not be needed. But obviously, to refine your surgical skills, you can obviously observe some people doing it. There is no rule as such that only oculoplasty surgeons are needed for an entropion surgery. But obviously, from a financial point of view, since we don't do cataracts, we would love to do your entropion surgeries.
Okay, let's move forward then, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Take care. There is presentation. You can just put on Dr. Milind's slide.
Yes, sir. Milind's slide. Okay, wait, sir.
Yeah.
Before sir proceeds with the introduction of Dr. Milind, I'll just take this opportunity that sir will be doing a formal introduction, but being Milind's friend, I would like to say a few words that he's a very witty person with a great comic sense, and he's a great painter and artist. Over to you, sir.
Yes, it's my honor to introduce Milind, who has taken Indian ophthalmology, especially the oculoplastic part, to international levels, and we have all seen it. So in brief, he's a MD from CMC. He's done his fellowship in ophthalmic facial and plastics in UCLA, which is one of the premier institute for oculoplasty worldwide. He's currently a consultant department of ophthalmic surgery at LV Prasad Eye Institute, and he's also an adjunct associate professor at University of Rochester. He has many achievements, but just a few. He has a senior achievement from the American Academy, and he was the vice president of Asia Pacific Society of Ophthalmic Plastic and Reconstructive Surgery. He has more than 250 peer-reviewed publications, more than 500 presentations. Of course, his area of interest is orbit oculoplastic aesthetics and facial surgery, and he does excellent workshops for even general ophthalmologists for plastic surgery. With this, I would ask Milind to please show some. His videos are extraordinary. They are so clean and they are so clear that I think these are one of the best videos that we can ever see. Over to you, Milind.
Thank you, sir. Are my slides visible?
Yeah.
Good evening, everyone. I'm just starting with a slide which dates back to 1992, I guess. And if many of you cannot recognize, this is Rujuta.
No. Never.
And that's me there in my most emaciated form ever in my life. So our friendship dates back to our MBBS days, and these were really golden times. And of course, BJ brought us all together. And not to forget Adit and Ramesh, who have been colleagues for so many years, students, and now they are, you know, co-partners in our quest towards resolving oculoplasty issues. So coming to the topic that I am going to talk about, Botox and fillers for general ophthalmologists. So I'm only going to focus on areas where I feel that you can get into as an experienced ophthalmologist. So coming back to the point of someone asking whether you need a fellowship to do this, I think that what we achieve in a plasty fellowship in 1 or 2 years, experienced ophthalmologists achieve that over a period of 10 to 15 years. Am I audible?
Yeah. Okay. We can hear you.
So absolutely, these are areas where you can get into. And I don't think, as Adit said, that fellowship is really a requirement. So talking about spasms, wrinkles, and hollows, I'll just touch upon Botox and filler. And we'll touch upon some functional and cosmetic areas. And I'll shift between the slides and videos if they're not running well. So talking about the toxin, we have three products that are available in the country right now. The most popular being botulinum toxin. And there are several, you know, sort of untested products available in the local market, which I wouldn't really recommend. This is a slide I use to explain the quadratic algorithm to identify spasm. So you can divide the face into four quadrants. And if there's only one area involved, let's say just the upper eyelid or the lower eyelid, it's usually myokemia, and we'll come to these videos. If both the quadrants in the upper half of the face are involved, it's benign essential blepharospasm. If two vertical quadrants are involved, then it's hemifacial on one side. And if you have a B face, then that's a Meek syndrome. And 99% of your facial spasms will fit into this quadratic algorithm. So this is a classic case of myokemia. Is the video running well?
Yeah, it's running.
Yes, you can see a slight twitching in the lower eyelid. This is something which we all from time to time might be getting if we have reduced sleep, we are an excessive tea or coffee drinker, or if you've traveled to another country with sleep timings reverse. As long as this is less than 3 months old, this cannot be labeled as a neurological disorder. Well, if it's bothering a patient, you can put in a drop of Botox to relieve it. But these are usually self-limiting. Just prescribing oral rehydration, adequate sleep, and water is enough. The main crux of spasms is the benign essential blepharospasm, and you can see a clip here where the patient is in distress on the left side. He's unable to keep his eyes open, and you have the same patient following Botox injection 2 weeks or 3 weeks down the line. So you're primarily using botulinum toxin to treat these patients. I'm just going to stop sharing this video, this presentation rather, and join back with a video here. Just a moment. Just let me know if the screen is visible there.
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay, so this this probably has its own audio, so I'm just going to run that for a couple of minutes.
So for the eyelid, we will first target the pre-tarsal orbicularis, which is a medial injection.
Are you able to hear the audio?
Yes, yes, we can hear. Yeah, we can hear the audio.
Pre-tarsal region, just above the punctum. Laterally, just above the canthus, would be the second point. In the lower eyelid, you would want to avoid the medial aspect. So in the mid-pupillary line, you can choose the pretarsal area here. And laterally, you could have one more point, which is just below the canthus. So you are essentially targeting the pretarsal muscles. And you can have one more point laterally, maybe a centimeter lateral to the lateral canthus. That would be your fifth eyelid point. Now, in addition to that, you would, if the brow is also protracting, you can divide the brow between three thirds, and then you can give it either at the junction of central and medial two-thirds, or you can give it at the junction of central and lateral one-third. So these injections would be up to a centimeter above the hair-bearing part of the brow, and you can already see that those marked points are moving down due to the action of the orbicularis muscle. You don't want to go higher than that, which is going to block the frontalis muscle, which is up here and which is actually trying to keep the eye open. So these would be the sites. In addition, the same component is repeated on the other side. And in addition, you can also have one central injection into the procerus muscle. When we are planning to give the injection in the corrugators, we can keep the thumb along the orbital rim and make sure that our markings are above it. We also would want to avoid the preseptal region and the subbrow region because that is closer to the levator muscle and that can cause ptosis with the injection procedure.
We are now going to inject Mr. Basavaraj with Botox. Prior to the injection, I have loaded the Botox into a 1 ml tuberculin syringe and it has a separate 30 gauge needle onto it. Before I begin the injection, I would make sure that the hub of the needle is in line with the markings on the syringe so I can see how much I am injecting while I am going in. It's very essential to doubly check that the needle is firmly pressed into the syringe and it is not loose. And I would prefer to have my thumb ready on the piston of the syringe so that I can inject. And the non-dominant hand would help me to show me the areas where I'm going to inject because the patient is going to have spasms while we are injecting. So it is necessary that you hold the spasms away while you inject. So let us begin with his left side. I'm going to start with the upper eyelid medial injection, which is pre-tarsal. We already had applied Pridlox in that area for last 30 to 45 minutes. So I just go under the skin, lift the edge and inject 0.1 ml in that area. Then I come laterally, just go under the skin, lift it up and inject. Now I'm giving the mid-pupillary injection in the pre-tarsal region, just going to hub depth of the needle, injecting and coming out. And my non-dominant hand actually keeps the eye open, so even if the patient suffers a spasm during the injection, it doesn't come in your way of injection process. So each site is receiving 0.1 ml with a 30 gauge needle. For the lateral injection, coming from the lateral aspect is in fact better because patient doesn't notice the syringe, which they are worried about sometimes. So the eyelid injections are now over. I would now inject the brow, and for the brow it is essential to keep your thumb on the superior orbital rim because many patients of this age would have brow ptosis and you don't want to inject too close to the orbital rim. So I would keep my thumb there, and at the pre-decided previous spot I'm going to go slightly deeper than what we would have done in the eyelid because the brow would have some subbrow fat pad. So the junction of medial and central third and the second junction of central and lateral third, these are the two spots that we had chosen for injection. Each one received 0.1 ml. Finally, I would give one in the center, which is the procerus. So that completes the left side for the injection. You can keep a bud or a tissue handy with you just in case there is some ooze, you can dab that. So I have just changed the syringe and we are going to now inject the right side.
So I'll exit the video here and we'll go back to the presentation. So that was a video demonstrating injection for spasms, and this is a case of hemifacial spasms. You can see this lady's spasm is only on one side. It's also involving the lower part of the face. The zygomaticus major, and that's her appearance 2 weeks down the line post injection. So for hemifacial spasm, the sites that we need for injection, in addition to the standard sites that we discussed, we also give it along the zygomaticus major muscle on the prominence of the zygoma. Then for the levator labi, just within the nasolabial fold, and you can treat the lower muscles like the mentalis or even the platysma based on what the patient wants. Sometimes we also inject the other side for symmetry. So here is another video of an ALO case. So you can notice that when he's instructed to open the eye, it takes a couple of seconds for him to do that voluntarily. And this can be a dangerous condition to have, especially on the roads and out in the outdoors. So this can often be present along with BB, or it can be in isolation. And in these patients, apart from the central and the medial and the lateral injection, you would also place a central injection to completely block the pretarsal muscle. So here the only difference in the upper eyelid is the central injection in the mid-pupillary line, in addition to the medial and the lateral, and as well as the one which is outside the canthus. So we repeat that on both sides. So you would have noticed that his lag definitely reduced after the injection. It may not get back to a normal person's level, but they definitely get comfortable. And in those in whom botulinum toxin does not work, what we do is orbicularis myectomy. And in our institute, what we are doing now is to use a nerve integrity monitor to specifically identify the branches of the facial nerve. So this instrument is basically used to target and identify the nerve endings so that you can remove that along with just the muscle. Coming to some of the cosmetic indications around the eye, this is a scenario where the prominent orbicularis role is treated with a drop of botulinum toxin in the lower eyelid in the mid-pupillary plane, just targeting the pretarsal and the preceptor muscle. And you can see that the smile remaining the same, the eyeball aperture is reduced. Crow's feet is another area where we target the botulinum toxin. That's the canthal lines. So you inject not only at the lateral canthus, but also a little bit into the inferolateral part of the lower eyelid so that there is a smooth continuum of the erased lines. Frown is another prominent area that we treat, either the expression itself or the lines that are caused by the frowning. Here you can see a frown being prominent in this lady when she's trying to swim. So we target the corrugator muscle in this 5-point fashion, and as you can see in this
over the vital region, I'm going into the depth.
Pretty much similar to what we did for benign essential nephrotic spasm. But the indication and the reason here is different. Similarly, targeting the frontalis muscle with injections, two rows of injections to treat the horizontal line. So here our goal is not to target the line when you treat, but to target the muscle beneath it so that we treat that area. Coming finally to some applications of filler. Filler is nothing but the hyaluronic acid that you all use in your cataract surgery. It's just that this product, which is used in tissues, is cross-linked. So it stays for a much longer time, up to a year and above. So here are two cases where the brow area is collapsed because of volume loss, and that is what is creating an extra fold of skin. So these are not opportunities to perform a bleph because that will not really work. Here what you need to do is to volumize the brow. And this is a quick video showing a brow volumization being done with a filler. So filler syringe is exactly similar to your Hylase that you will use for cataract. it's equally viscous. And what we are doing is trying to go into the subbrow fat outside the orbital rim to fill this anatomy. So it's not this fat we are targeting, which is orbital, but the subbrow fat, which is beyond the orbital rim margin. So here you can see the collapsed brow, which is filled with a filler, and you get that convex contour. And you also see that the fold of skin is no more there because you've re-inflated the brow. That's the pre-post. Here is the other pre-post. And finally, coming to the tear trough area, which is a very commonly done indication by oculoplastic surgeons. Many dermatologists are not too comfortable with this, considering the fact that blindness is a very rare complication of this procedure. So what we are targeting here is this tear trough deformity, which in many of us could be an anatomic finding, but if it is bothering the patient in terms of a tired look, then filler is the best way to really do this. So what we do is apply topical anesthesia with Prilox for 15 to 20 minutes and then begin the injection procedure. We do one side followed by the other. Follow them up at 1 or 2 weeks time to do any kind of touch up that may be required. And usually filler is used in many areas other than the under eye at the same time and can be even clubbed with Botox. So this is really an area where ophthalmologists can score over their dermat colleagues because this is our area, so to speak. And these are just a couple of examples of tear trough treatments being done pre and post. So just to come back to our summary now. Toxin, most common applications functional would be spasms, of which benign essential blepharospasm and hemifacial would be the commonest. For the filler, the two commonest periocular applications would be tear trough deformity and brow volumization. And as you get experienced with it, you can spread your spread over the entire face for the treatment part. And yes, there are many functional as well as cosmetic indications for both. It's always good to start with the functional and then venture into the cosmetic treatments. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. That was a wonderful presentation. Something new for general ophthalmologist point of view.
Thank you.
Now we are going to have a question.
Yes, go ahead. How frequently you have to inject these patients, especially the blepharospasms, which commonly come to us? And
spasm patients every 3 to 4 months. Within that, the hemifacial spasm lasts a little longer than benign essential blepharospasm. And many of these patients do have this misconception that once you start it, you have to continue and there is some kind of a dependency. So it's important to tell them that that's not the case. If you discontinue it, your problem remains how it was earlier, and it can always be chosen and taken episodically. Like some patients come only when they have something important in their life, like a function or a marriage or whatever.
One question to Dr. Milind about the fillers, like medically.
Vijita, you are breaking up.
You have to repeat the question, Vijita.
Can you hear me now?
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I wanted to ask Dr. Milind, regarding the fillers, like you talked about Botox, that the patient has to come every 3 to 4 months. Regarding the fillers, cosmetic use, okay? So for that, what is the frequency? Well, and regarding the fillers, is there a dependency?
fillers last much longer than Botox, and in the under eye area, 1 year is an average you can consider, but most of us find that it lasts longer than that. 2 years could be an average. And it's not really a dependency, but once you start any process which makes you look better and you can afford it, then the patients would want to come back to it again. So it's like going to the parlor. You might want to go again if you looked earlier better and you thought it was safe and good.
Basically, I wanted to ask one thing, that after the patients start using fillers, say for example, they use fillers for 4 years, and after that, they don't want to use it. So is there a reverse effect on that, or it reflects only?
Not really. But you have to tell the patients that while you are under the influence and effect of filler, your body is still continuing to age. So if you are taking the fillers over certain years and one day the filler disappears, if the aging process looks a little more, it's not caused by the filler. You are just aging in the background.
Exactly.
It's important to tell them that.
Yes, that is very important. I need to ask this question because I might use fillers after some years. That's why I'm asking, making it clear. Thank you, Dr. Malin.
Sir, can I ask one question? Sir, any allergic reactions do you get after this fillers, or any contraindication for these fillers or Botox?
Well, earlier as the products have evolved, the issues of allergy have certainly reduced. For example, botulinum toxin used to have albumin within it earlier to and people who have albumin allergy or egg allergy could potentially have issues with it. But now the newer products, they do not have albumin. Similarly with the fillers, since it's entirely an hyaluronic acid product, which is a common ingredient of all our connective tissues, we do not usually see allergies with them. A lot of non-approved filler materials and semi-permanent fillers can cause allergies. But with HA, I haven't really seen a true allergy. It could be bruising, and it could be overfilling sometimes, but not really allergy. It's very rare.
Any contraindications for fillers and Botox?
Well, for Botox, certainly patients who have myogenic doses or any myogenic dystrophies, you would not want to inject something which really paralyzes the neuromuscular junction. But the amount of units that we use in the periocular region, even if it were to go into the venous system, arterial system, it's not really going to affect the patient's life in any way. But those are potential contraindications. Pregnancy and children are the two untested areas by the drug. Although we've injected in children as off-label thing, but not in pregnancy. So I would say these are the potential so-called contraindications.
Thank you,
sir. Does the Botox causes muscle weakness in long run if we give it for more time?
There is no evidence of that. It's not known that it really atrophies the muscle in any way.
Okay, and what is the costing for fillers and Botox? Can a normal person afford it? Like, we can give it to in our clinics. So what is the costing for that, sir?
For the Allergan brand, which is Botox, I think its vial price is close to 16,000 for 100 unit vial. So if you're talking about one unit, it's going to really cost you 160 rupees as a cost price. So if you add your own procedure charge to it, then any patient is going to, you know, be costing around 200 rupees minimum for per unit cost. So if you're talking about hemifacial spasm, for example, you're looking at 15 units, then you're really talking about 3,000 to 4,000 rupees as a start point. And for hemifacial, you could double that or maybe make it 2.5 times of that. So you're looking at a costly and repetitive treatment, but certainly is the first line, because surgeries don't always work. for these patients.
And it can be preserved, the vial can be preserved how long, sir?
Vial at 4 degrees can be preserved for a week, although people have noticed that its utility stays effective for 6 weeks if you store it at 4 degrees. From the bacterial standpoint, beyond 1 week is not preferable because it does not contain any bacteriostatic drug. So okay. If your syringe aspirations introduce some bacteria, they're really going to grow inside. And if you make an ice ball and store it in a deep freezer, it's supposed to be viable for at least 6 months. This is published literature.
And so fillers, costing for the fillers?
Fillers, an average filler is available as a Vanimal brand. And they could cost anything between 15,000 to 20 or 22,000 based on how many you buy at a time. So if you add your procedure charge to it, a 1 ml filler would cost on an average 30,000 for a patient. And that price could vary if you move from Nasik to Mumbai, and the price would be highest in Mumbai and lowest in
Nasik,
for example.
Adit can be say that.
There's charges. One question for Dr. Ramesh. Can I ask Dr. Ramesh? Regarding the eyelid injuries, I want to ask you one question. And when there is a ragged incision, not a clear-cut incision, involving the upper lid as well as the lid margin, what are the tips and tricks you would like us to follow?
So most of these lid injuries that we come across, we always feel that there is loss of tissue. So many times there's no loss of tissue, it's just the lid splits apart and they both go in different directions. So the first thing is we don't have to be afraid. What we need to do is we have to clean the wound properly and we open up all the tissues threadbare. You open it up properly and you see that everything will fall in place, and then you put it like a jigsaw puzzle and you start switching from the lid margins. First, we suture the tarsal plate and then the margins, we double mantle sutures, and then anterior and posterior marginal sutures, and then through the tarsal plate, and then you go for layer by layer suture, the orbicularis and then the skin. So the first thing is don't worry, you should, there's no tissue loss. Second thing is open up the wound completely. And you see that it's much bigger wound than actually what you see. And look for any foreign bodies, clean it up with betadine, and then suture layer by layer following the principles. And the outcome will be very, very beautiful. And there's hardly a scar in the lid actually. So it's very forgiving kind of wounds in the lid.
Thank you, Dr.
Dr. Milind, with regards to fillers. Hello. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Milind, with regards to fillers, what would be the end point of your injection? Like, would you want it to be slightly overfilled so that, in short, do you expect any regression over time? So, what would be the end point of your actually when you're injecting?
So, filler injections, especially tear trough, is a combination of science and art. And we always tend to underdo, because sometimes these fillers can imbibe a little bit of tissue fluid and they can swell. So underdoing it and re-examining at the end of 1 or 2 weeks to find out if we need any touch-up. So there are always cases where we need to put in a little bit more, or sometimes even dissolve something that was irregular and accidentally formed. So it's always a process, and for the same patient every time, the filling effect could be slightly different because it's more of an artistic job apart from the science behind it. So yes, we usually stop on the underdoing side and then add more if required.
One more question for all three of you regarding the facial aesthetics. Is it any area which cannot be explored by the ophthalmologist in case of facial aesthetics?
Well, if you look at the FACO AIOS curriculum, that already involves all the periocular aesthetic procedures that we do, Botox, fillers, blepharoplasty. Maybe if you want to venture beyond the orbit, which is the forehead, brow, or the lower face, there you could have certain medical legal issues. But if you are fellowship trained, then you already know these areas. You have a certification course that you did, which has trained you in that area. And it's always good to over inform these patients about potential problems so that they are aware.
And regarding the general ophthalmologist, which all things can we like medically, which all things can we do in as regards the facial aspects?
Well, Adit, Ramesh, you want to take that?
I think
anybody of you can answer.
I think we can do all the procedures on the lid. It's not an issue. Results can be sometimes surprising, and patients may be unhappy. But provided you take a proper consent, I don't think it should be a problem.
Yeah, I agree. Especially facial aesthetics, injectables. The basic requirement, I think, is understanding of the anatomy. And even we even have some MBBS doctors who perform these procedures. So I don't think that having an MS degree obviously adds to the value. So around the eye, we are certainly competent enough. But if you want to venture into other areas, short-term courses or fellowships might be of benefit. But there is no medico-legal implication if you do injectables on the face, since you are a certified doctor and registered with your medical council.
Good. Nikita?
Yes, sir.
Any other questions, sir?
Sir, for there are no questions from the audience, sir, in the comment session. Sir, for Ramesh Murthy, sir, I have one question. Sir, is it like a partial thickness lid tear can be left apart for cell filling, or we have
revise the scar?
Okay.
So
and in pediatric cases, the wound edges. Pediatric cases also.
Yeah,
they
also
actually don't allow us to do anything. They like leave it like that.
Properly we counsel and tell them that this will leave a depressed scar. If it's acceptable to you, it's fine. We'll leave it alone. Some people use some kind of strips to, like we sometimes use strips to get the two edges supposed. It's a very, lax skin, like in the upper lid. If it's possible, we try to put a strip and try to oppose the tissues. So you may not, not need to suture these cases.
Mm-hmm. Okay, sir. Okay, now, any questions from the audience? Sir, I think we should conclude the session. Take out a stool.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Nitika. Yeah. The basic, the purpose of this webinar, which went on very well, was as it came in the discussion. We as ophthalmologists, general ophthalmologists, or doing conventional work, are so busy with our cataracts that sometimes we, forget if there's anything beyond cataract. And this I realized when I went for a small fellowship, a small observership to Moorfield, where actually I was supposed to join FICO, but there was no some vacancy. So I joined in oculoplastic, and I saw it's a huge field, and there was so many things done. And now we have seen from these three stalwarts that it's a huge and ever-expanding field. There are so many things which are being done, and so many things which we can do. We see every day that dermatologists getting Botox, we see plastic surgeons doing fillers, and we also see, facial maxillary surgeons doing all kind of surgeries. Even ptosis was done by plastic surgeons, and I think that was that's not correct. So this is a very good initiative that we are doing what we should have been doing for long. And we have seen here, we can do cosmetics, we can do aesthetics, and we can also do a good plastic work. So I think it's for everyone. We can take this up. It's not that difficult. As Milind said, there are so many courses, and I attended a few at Elu Prasad also. They give very good hands-on training. I mean, hands-on training for oculoplasty is not that easy, but they do it. So this is our field. Yes, we should recapture it. It was people had encroached on it. So I think we should take home message is that yes, we are authorized, or we are all we can do it, and we should do it.
Sir, one quick point I want to make. So today, Dr. Milind, one patient came. She had a bilateral canalicular block, and she said, "I have come for plastic surgery." So I didn't understand what to do. So I was very shocked. So I said, "Plastic? Have you brought any plastic?" So it was very funny because she had been guided by somebody properly counseled that she needs plastic surgery and only I can do it. It was very difficult for me to convince her the other way around that possibly canonical block does not need plastic surgery. So that was a very interesting moment of the day.
Jutta?
No, I think Dr. Seema Kerim.
One minute. Just before Seema starts, I think, Raman, do you have something to say from Entod?
Yes, sir.
Or Rahul?
So, yeah. Yes, there is a video from Entod, sir.
Yeah. Yeah, I would like to share my screen, sir.
Yeah, yes, please.
Thank you so much to all doctor for giving the opportunity. This webinar is supported by Entod Pharmaceuticals. Here we will just have our video presentation of our recently got BCG approved product, where is Philippine Plus. As India's fastest growing optical and ENT company in this current scenario, to over to you, sir.
Thank you, Raman. Seema?
Good evening, all. I'm Dr. Seema Khare, proposing vote of thanks. I thank chairperson and judges for the clinical cases segment. And I thank Dr. Milind Naik, master in oculoplasty, for accepting our invite and enlightening us about the Botox and fillers, which are very much useful for the general ophthalmologist in their practice. Our very own Dr. Ramesh Murthy, a well-known oculoplastic surgeon, I thank him for his presentation on and useful tips and techniques on the lid suturing techniques. I thank Dr. Adit for helping us to know the Endrobion surgical steps easily. I thank Dr. Nitika for moderation of the session. I thank President POS, Dr. Sanjay Tekode, and our very own Secretary, Dr. Rujita, for taking very good efforts for this wonderful webinar. I thank Entod for the technical support, and I declare the webinar is over. Thank you very much. Good night.
And before we disperse, our usual POS ritual of a screenshot. So please switch on your video so that we can take a screenshot. Mr. Rahul?
And we smile also, right?
Yes.
Yeah,
please switch on your video, everybody.
Optoplastic smile. Milind.
Sure.
It's a pretty long smile, yeah.
Yeah. Mr. Rahul, is it done? I hope Mr. Rahul is there. Yeah, thank you.
Raman. Thanks.
Yes, wonderful presentations. Milin, I think it was enjoyable.